Hello and welcome to SBS 318, Immigration and Citizenship. My name is Mike Fraga, and I am your guide for this particular class. And this course seeks to understand some of the issues that concern the contemporary United States immigrant population in general, and the Mexican and Central American immigrant population in specific. The historical experiences of the diverse immigrant populations that created and continue to create the economic and social foundation of the United States will be surveyed, and along with the legal steps that an immigrant must follow in order to achieve citizenship. And this is done in an effort to bring awareness to the contemporary human crisis. And this course explores immigration policy and its effects on the Chicano, Mexicano, Latino communities in specific and the U.S. society as a whole. And the purpose of the course is to learn about the dilemma of U.S. immigration, its history, its policy, and current crisis. And despite the fact that the United States claims to be a nation of immigrants, the immigration process has evoked a wide range of responses from various sectors of the U.S. population. And these responses include fear and anxiety, sympathy, hate, ethnocentrism, misunderstanding, racial profiling, scapegoating, and xenophobia. Yet immigrants continue to come to the United States in search of work, family unification, better opportunities, asylum, and refuge. So for those of you in cable land, there's an 800 number that is available for you. And by all means, please call in if you have any questions or comments about the topics that will be covered today. And students, please take advantage of the online address and chat with me as we explore the concepts for the course. And today's session will bring a close to the native dimension to immigration and citizenship, and then begin to introduce ourselves to the European immigrant tradition. And so for today, we'll want to kind of close out what I had presented 2 weeks ago. And all too often, when we do refer to the United States as a nation of immigrants, Native peoples are always dropped from the discourse. And yet it is their homeland which every immigrant group will eventually come to occupy. So I deliberately began this course with Native people's experiences. And by understanding Native experiences with their environment and their eventual removal from their homelands, we can come to an appreciation of why every citizen of the United States must give thanks to the original inhabitants of the Western Hemisphere and of this turtle's back. These Native peoples at times welcomed immigrants, and then most often throughout history were forced through war to make room for immigrants. And in this presentation, we're going to come to a close, come to an appreciation of Native people's rich Native traditions, which form the basis, which form the foundation of our existence today. And so the last presentation, I had emphasized that the United States at its inception did not recognize Native peoples as part of the new experiment in nation building. In fact, Thomas Jefferson will familiarize himself with, as we covered last session, the doctrine of discovery. And will write one of the most racist statements enshrined as part of the Declaration of Independence. Merciless Indian savages, that was the term that he used. School children will learn very early in their lives the prejudices of the founding fathers of this nation. Native peoples will not be accorded the rights and privileges of citizenship until 1924. In the first week of this course, I had introduced you to concepts concerning the racialization process, and I want to go over these concepts again just so that you can appreciate one more time the importance of racialization. And I shared with you that racism is an instrument of power used by those in power to perpetuate their power. And so this racialization process, students, if it invokes feelings in you, well, then get in touch with your feelings. I'm not responsible for your feelings. You get in touch with them so that you can appreciate something about how it is that you have experienced, in this particular case, Native peoples. Thomas Jefferson knew very well what he was doing when he phrased merciless Indian savages into the Declaration of Independence. So I want to go over these concepts once more time, once again, so as to appreciate how a society can come to hate a population and create a process of removal and elimination. And the reason why I'm going to do this again is because we are very close to coming to that, especially with regards to the Mexican question and what is happening today in the debate with regards to undocumented workers. Now, as Americans, we must come to understand that everyone has been educated and influenced in society by this process known as racialization. Racism is an instrument of power used by those in power to perpetuate their power. Keep this in mind, and let's understand this process very carefully. And since the inception of this nation, racism and sexism operated most effectively at the national level by keeping specific populations in a disadvantaged position. And they did it through policies that called for the elimination of Native peoples, the enslavement of Africans, the disfranchisement of poor whites, the discrimination against women, the discrimination against Asians, the conquest through war of Mexican territory, the denial of citizenship to Asians, and the creation of an apartheid system meant to create a racialist order. And as I shared with you, one of my favorite sayings, of course, is racism is like diarrhea being inherited. It runs in your genes. Now, all Americans have a prejudice. Now, think of all the prejudices that one has about the people that make up a part of this nation. What are all the jokes that you've heard from the comedians about blacks, about Native peoples, about Mexicans, about Chinese, about women? We all have prejudices. I have a prejudice. I have a prejudice. I do not like canned green beans. And just take a look at these beans. These beans, they're slimy, they're green, they're alien beans. And we can get a close-up of it. You can kind of see what it is that I mean about these green alien beans. They are waxy. They look alien to me. If you see these green beans, I just don't like them. Now, prejudice is a personal expression. I have a means by which to carry out my prejudice, and that is a stereotype. I call these beans green, slimy, alien beans. And the social result of my individual expression, of course, is that I want to avoid these beans. I avoid this distinct population of beans that I'm stereotyping. I do not like them. I will not eat them. Now, on the other hand, you know, I like white beans. You know, white beans, man, they're very tasty. I also like red beans. Red beans, you know, I brought all my beans with me. I like red beans. You know, look at these red beans. Don't those red beans just look delicious right next to those white beans? I also like black beans. I mean, who doesn't like black beans? Black beans, you know, they're from Guatemala. Oops, let's see if we can get them in. Everybody has equal space here. I like those black beans. I also like garbanzo beans. And garbanzo beans, you know, garbanzo beans, these yellow beans, man, they are tasty. And, of course, you combine all those beans together, you get the get down, the get brown beans. These are the pinto beans, and those pinto beans, they're just amazing. So, you know, these are the beans that I like. These beans, they are delicious. You know, I've got all the colors represented here. They're just fantastic. Don't you just think that they're delicious? But you see, when you take a look at these green beans just are, they just don't fit, do they? I do not like it. Now, one of the things that's most important to appreciate here. Now, what if I want to carry out my personal prejudice to the societal level? Let's say I want to influence all of society into hating these green beans. I don't like these canned green beans. You know, they just aren't as nutritious as all of these other ones. So let's say I were to open up a restaurant and I want to serve all of these beans, these real pretty beans, these brown beans, black beans, you know, yellow beans. But let's say I don't want to serve these canned green beans. So what can I do to keep these beans from appearing in the restaurant? Well, in order for me to put up a sign to inform the public that canned green beans will not be served, I need the law behind me. And so let's say I go to my city council or to my state government or to the federal government and I vote to have legislation that allows me to discriminate against these canned green beans. So with the law behind me, I can now legally discriminate against these green, slimy, alien beans. So the next step after my prejudice, and my prejudice is personal, but the next step is to take it into the societal level, and that next step is discrimination. Now, while the social action to carry out my prejudice was a stereotype, the social action to carry out my discrimination is the law. I made it legal. discrimination is made legal. Now I am practicing racism. It is when I take it out into the public and I can influence another person, another being's lives. As long as I keep my prejudice to myself, I am not a racist. I'm just a bigoted fool. But with the law behind me, the green beings I am discriminating against are now in a disadvantaged position. I am using an instrument of power to perpetuate my power. Now, the disadvantaged population, these canned green beans, as opposed to all of these delicious beans here, these canned green beans just aren't going to stack up. So these canned green beans, they're going to be in a disadvantaged population. They're going to be in a disadvantaged position because now they have to face a four-part process of inequity. They have to face the discrimination that's being railed against them. And then, of course, they're not going to be able to improve their taste or their status by going to education and, becoming flavorful like these beans. They're not going to have access to education. So these canned beans will not have the opportunity to improve their flavor over all of these delicious beans that I like. Now, what's important to recognize is that after that, they're going to not be able to affect the decision-making process because they're not going to be able to get the right to vote to stop the laws that are against them because these beans, they're in a favored position. These beans are not. So the canned green beans will not be allowed the opportunity to influence the political decision-making process. This impacts their disadvantaged situation. And then most importantly, let's say these beings want to go and find a job, and they must face economic marginality, or what is referred to as economically as a dual wage structure. They experience economic marginality. They will not be paid the same amount of money as these other delicious beings. Now, the odds are against the targeted beings, but I know that all beings want to be liked. I don't know of any being that doesn't want to be eaten. My mom used to dress up these green beans by hiding them in eggs with chorizo. But I always saw them. I saw them despite, them trying to be dressed up in different things, just to be accepted. Because, beans will dress up in any way they can just to be accepted. I don't know of any beans who don't want to be dressed up. I just don't like canned green beans. No matter how much they try to look like these other beans or try to pass off like these other delicious beans. But let's take it another step further. Let's say I don't want these green beans to accompany the same shelf as these precious black beans, brown beans, red beans, or yellow beans. So I introduced segregation. I'm going to move them away from these beans. These beans, they're precious. They're going to be in an advantaged position, whereas these beans, I'm going to take them away from these beans. I'm segregating them. So I introduce segregation, and the way that I do it is I have the law behind me because I'm going to make it legal to prevent those green beans from being in the same cupboard as my favorite beans. So I implement segregation, and the means by which to carry out that segregation is the law. I have made it legal. And the social result, of course, is that I now have isolated the green beans. I have separated them from the favorite beans. Now, how can I influence society to come to hate these green beans? How have I come to loathe these green beans? After all, Cesar Chavez always reminded me during his talks in his bilingual expression, we are all human beings. Aren't we all human beings? Think about Native peoples, poor white indentured servants, African slaves, Asian immigrants, Mexicans, and now Muslims. Aren't we all human beings? What is the next step after segregation? Of course, that is to eliminate the population, is to get these out of the way, period, totally out of the way. So to commit genocide is an abominable act, don't you think? I know of no one born a sexist or a racist, yet Americans can frighteningly go down this path of hatred just like the Germans did with Hitler and the Jews. Or have Americans, as we're going to experience now, carved out this path already with Native peoples? Why are there reservations? Why is there the state of Oklahoma? All Americans need is some hysterical moment where the national character can get whipped up into a frenzy, and there goes all the liberties that have been written in the Constitution to prevent such things from happening. This is one of the reasons why the U.S. experienced the Civil Rights Movement. The Civil Rights Movement was about getting the government out of the business of discrimination, segregation, and elimination. So as we follow the logic of prejudice, stereotype, and avoidance, of discrimination, making it legal and creating a disadvantaged population, to segregation, making it legal and then isolating the population, what is next? How does the society come to hate? And did the U.S. commit genocide? That is a question that's debated, especially amongst Native American historians who challenge American historians in appreciating something about what happened in the 19th century. What is removal all about? So remember, I don't know, Crew, if you can get my patch here. I deliberately wore this shirt so that we can appreciate something about us being human beings. We are all human beings. I don't know if you can focus in on my shirt here. I don't know if it's too small. Okay, thank you very much anyway. But in my shirt I wear, we are all human beings. I knew that when I got the shirt, I should have had it full across the chest, but maybe next time. But as we have learned in this course, President Andrew Jackson implemented a policy known as the Indian Removal Act, and which challenged all Native peoples east of the Mississippi River to move west. And the Cherokee experience with removal became known as the Trail of Tears, and they referred to it as Tears because on their way to being removed to what is known today as the state of Oklahoma, they shed their blood along the trail. Now, we viewed a film clip in the last presentation that assisted us in visualizing the Cherokee removal process. And when the United States, after that removal process, is going to go to war with Mexico, and when the United States gains the lands that once belonged to Mexico, the Native peoples there, likewise, are going to encounter the same removal policy. The Navajo and the Apache were formidable groups who resisted both Mexican and U.S. economic expansion. Let's appreciate what the Navajo referred to as the Long Walk. And let's appreciate something about their history, the Navajo, their history with removal. Their experience with genocide is known as Bosque Redondo and the Long Walk. So let's listen to a Navajo woman, Nanabad Nez, as she shares her understanding of what happened to her people.
In the Great Southwest, white settlers begin moving farther and farther west. America is expanding. Soon they are spilling past the sacred mountains onto Navajo land. The Navajo, a fiercely territorial tribe who's managed to fight off intruders for centuries, begin raiding the white settlements with hopes of scaring them off. It didn't work. The Navajo and Mescalero Apache tribes are deemed hostile and picked for removal from their homeland in order to be tamed. April, 1863. Navajo chiefs Barbancito and Delgadito are offered two choices: voluntarily leave their homeland or fight to the death. Pleas from the Navajo people were ignored.
To leave this place would violate our deepest beliefs. This is where our ancestors meant us to be. This is where we are supposed to live and to die.
August, 1863. It begins. General James Carleton authorized Colonel Christopher Carson to launch the Scorched Earth Expedition against the tribes.
The Indians are to be soundly whipped. Kill all Indian men wherever and whenever you find them. Take prison the women and children. Lay waste the land and homes with fire. Leave nothing behind.
And so the soldiers came and burned their cornfields, burned their hogans, molested women and children, and slaughtered their livestock. Hundreds of Navajo men died trying to protect their homes from the U.S. government troops. It took less than a year, starving, freezing, and dying from exposure, for the Navajo to surrender. March 6, 1864. The first of several groups began their walk to Fort Sumner. 2,400 people began the long walk. Also known as Bosco Redondo. Bosco Redondo was a concentration camp, the final solution to the problem of the unwanted tribes. Worn down, run down, frozen, starved, and forced to march to the Bosco Redondo, where the winters were deadly cold and the summers were deadly hot. For thousands of Navajo, it was the end. Some say they were not expected to survive. The 328-mile walk would take them across enemy territory, across hundreds of miles of harsh desert. Many adults carried children. Women were pregnant. The elderly, all wearing moccasins and burdened with loads of their possessions. There was no rest. You kept up, or you were killed. Troops would drive the people up to 30 miles a day at gunpoint. 330 miles later, they arrived at the Bosco Redondo. The government promised food. They promised shelter. They didn't come through. The winter was long and hard. They tried to farm, but the land was arid and food wouldn't grow. The few crops that were raised were attacked by insects and suffered from flood, drought, and hail. Government rations were meager and of poor quality. The flour the Navajo received was often full of bugs. Other food, foreign to the Navajo diet, often made them sick. Soon, the Apache ran away, and the Navajo began to die. It soon became evident that Carleton's idea was a failure. The tribe was dying by the thousands of starvation, disease, and exposure. After 4 long years of allowing this experiment, President Johnson ordered their release. And so, 4 years later, the Navajo returned home. They had nothing. Their homes were burned, their crops were ruined. They would have to start over. But they were home. Great-great-granddaughter of Bahi Shandi, survivor of the long walk. My name is Nana Banez, one who returns home, and I am still here.
Nana Banez, the most passionate rendition of what happened to her people. And as she says, she's still here. Yamuna, thank you for asking a question. We have a student named Yamuna. Does genocide always involve death, or can it just be pushing a certain group of people out of the country or into a certain area? It's a very good question, Yamuna, because what genocide refers to is that it is a conscious policy of elimination at a federal level. where there is, again, the instrument of power being used to perpetuate a power. So, you know, the genocide is fraught with debate, or it's with difficulty in terms of trying to prove if somebody did commit genocide or not. But, again, the question is how do you go about interpreting the historical record? And there is a debate amongst scholars, especially Native American scholars, in describing U.S. policy in that way. So thank you, Yamuna, and keep Yamuna, you might be able to answer that question because I'm going to have a couple more film clips where you can come to terms with what it is that you are asking. Ramzan, you asked, you're making a statement that says, it appears in most cases discrimination occurs due to ignorance amongst the groups about each other's culture and belief system, not willing to accept the people for who they are. Well, very, very good, Ramzan. Yes, ultimately, our prejudices and our discriminatory practices are based on our unwillingness to reach out to the other, to the not me, to the stranger at the gate. But there's also something else involved, Ramzan, and that is the economic motive, because after all, Native peoples are occupying resource-rich lands that are coveted by industry and industrialists. So there is always an economic motive for removal of a population. Always take a look at that. So let's take a look at, let's visit another episode of Elimination, and maybe Yamuna and Ramzan, you'll be able to continue down this discourse of appreciation for removal. After all, between 1830 to 1850, Native peoples were removed to make way for the first wave of immigrants. And then after the Civil War, Native peoples are going to be removed to make way for the second, to make room for the second wave of immigrants. So let's visit another episode of Elimination known as the Sand Creek Massacre. And the Sand Creek Massacre is also known as the Shivington Massacre or the Battle of Sand Creek. But it was an incident in the Indian Wars of the United States that occurred between 1860s to 1880s. And on November 29th, 1864, there was a 700-man force of Colorado Territory Militia that attacked and destroyed a village of friendly Cheyenne and Arapaho that were encamped in southeastern Colorado Territory. And they killed and mutilated an estimated 163 Indians, about two-thirds of whom were women and children. And the location has been designated a National Historic Site, and it is administered by the National Park Service. So if we could put on the bottom thirds, Sand Creek Massacre, as the conflict between Indians and white settlers and soldiers in Colorado continued, many of the Cheyenne and the Arapaho, including bands under Cheyenne chiefs Black Kettle and White Antelope, are going to be resigned to negotiate peace. And these hereditary specialists had sought to maintain peace in spite of pressure from whites. And they were told to camp near Fort Lyon on the eastern plains and that their people would be regarded as friendly. Now, assured by the U.S. government's promises of peace, Black Kettle is going to send most of his warriors to go and hunt for food, leaving around 60 men, women, and children in the village. And most of the men were too old or too young to hunt. And Black Kettle flew an American flag over his lodge, since previously the officers had said that this would show he was friendly and would prevent attacks by U.S. soldiers. So setting out from Fort Lyon, a Colonel Shivington and his 800 troops of 1st Colorado Cavalry, the 3rd Colorado Cavalry, and a company of 1st New Mexico Volunteers marched to Black Kettle's campsite. And on the night of November 28, 1864, soldiers and militia drank heavily and celebrated their anticipated victory. In the morning of November 29, 1864, Shivington ordered his troops to attack. Let's watch a film clip that will assist us in appreciating what happened at Sand Creek.
Council held at Camp Weld. Shivington, a former minister, was the military commander in Colorado Territory and nominal head of the 3rd Colorado Regiment, formed exclusively to hunt down Indians. At the meeting, Black Kettle said, "All we ask is that we may have peace with the whites. You are our father. We've been traveling through a cloud. The sky has been dark ever since the war began. In return, Evans accused the Cheyenne of initiating hostilities and said, "The time when you can make war best is in the summertime. When I can make war best is in the winter. You, so far, have had the advantage. My time is just coming." At the end of the conference, Shivington stated, "My rule of fighting white men or Indians is to fight them until they lay down their arms and submit to military authority. They're a nearer Major Wynkoop than anyone else, and they can go to him when they get ready to do that." Ironically, both sides wanted peace, and yet the conference ended without any firm commitment to peace from either side. Indian historian D. Brown wrote that Black Kettle took Shippington's remarks to mean that Black Kettle's people would be safe if he brought them to Fort Lyon on the Arkansas River. However, other historians dispute this claim, pointing out that when the Indians went back to Fort Lyon, they stopped at the cattle ranch owned by John Prowers and told him they could not make any treaty of peace with them, meaning Evans and Shivington. On November 9, 1864, Black Kettle and the Cheyenne began arriving at Fort Lyon. By this time, Wynkoop had been relieved of his command for being too soft on Indians, such as giving them food and supplies against orders. The new commander, Major Scott Anthony, directed Black Kettle and his band to camp 40 miles to the northeast on the Big Sandy, also known as Sand Creek. Meanwhile, Shivington had other plans.
Colonel Shivington, who had been at the Camp Weld Council in Denver in September 64, learned at that meeting that the Indians that he had been hunting for and hoping to kill for several years were probably camped at the Fort Lyon area or on the Big Sandy Creek nearby. In mid-November, he left Denver with his troops, headed downriver down the Arkansas to Fort Lyon, which he reached on the night of November 28th.
On November 28th, now in command of 700 troops armed with short-barreled carbines and pistols, and with four 12-pound mountain howitzers, Shivington ordered his cavalry to march to Black Kettle's encampment.
There were probably 115, 120 teepees here, with maybe 500 men, women, and children. Shivington approached from the south, approached the village. Some of the Indians actually went out to meet him. As a matter of fact, some of the first casualties of the fight here were two Colorado troopers who were shot down off of their horses. There was no mass charge through this village. Shivington had dismounted his men, and they actually walked through the village, allowing the Indians to escape up creek and a little bit more to the north, northwest up the creek. The soldiers walked through the village. When they got to the far end, they saw the Indians fleeing, and it was at that time that many of the officers lost control of their men. And the men, almost on an individual basis, started going after the fleeing Indians. They chased them up creek for several miles. As they ran, the Indians dug in at points all along the creek bed, dug themselves homemade rifle pits to make little defensive positions. The soldiers chased them throughout the rest of the day on the 29th. The battle lasted from dawn up until about 3 o'clock in the afternoon. So it was quite a long, drawn-out affair. There were quite a few casualties, more than we would think of. The soldiers took 76 casualties. That was about 25 killed and 51 wounded, which may not sound like a lot, but in the context of the Indian Wars, that was a heck of a fight. That was put Sand Creek up at the top of all the fights in the Indian Wars as per casualties. As for the Indians, that was pretty devastating to them also. They lost probably upwards of 150 killed. The things that distinguished Sand Creek here was afterwards, after the battle, the atrocities. Some of the men, again, lost control. They no doubt were angry. They had known what had happened through the rest of the summer with the Indian raiding, the massacre of the Hungate family in June outside of Denver. And the soldiers were taking vengeance. They had scalped and mutilated a lot of the Cheyenne bodies after the fight. The I no doubt they saw this as a just vengeance and a great victory. For the Cheyennes, of course, they view the event as a massacre.
Miraculously, Black Kettle survived, even while returning to save his wounded wife. However, Shivington's massacre at Sand Creek elevated the Cheyenne military societies, particularly the Dog Soldiers, into power. Americans back east were horrified by the Sand Creek massacre. Lincoln removed Governor Evans, and 2 months after Sand Creek, Shivington was out of the service. Black Kettle's peace attempts had failed, and now the Cheyenne, Arapaho, and Sioux, enraged by Sand Creek, chose to make war to the knife. The massacres in Minnesota and Sand Creek inflamed passions on both sides, and for the next 26 years, there'd be a battle to the death for the Great Plains.
Okay, so that's one of the most fascinating chapters in U.S. history is right after the Civil War, what the United States does to pacify and, try to connect the markets. It's markets, markets, markets. You have to connect St. Louis all the way to California. So the native peoples are going to experience removal. Jesse, you have a particular question that says, how does the Navajo concentration camp compare to the camps the Japanese were put in during World War II? Well, that's a great question, Jesse. Thank you for asking it. What's going to happen, Jesse, is that in this class we are going to cover the Japanese experience. So perhaps just keep your notes right now on appreciating something about the Navajo, the Cherokee, and the Sand Creek. I'm going to end with understanding something about Wounded Knee, so that you can appreciate something about how the United States could go down this path again, and this time with the Japanese. I will be covering the Japanese concentration experience later on in the course when I get to the Asian dimension. And then Courtney, thank you for asking, Jesse. And then Courtney, you have a question. It says, how did the government so blatantly disregard Native culture in every way, but then allow by law for Native burial grounds to be untouched? Oh, well, Courtney, the Native burial grounds, it is not until after the American Indian Movement in the 1960s and 70s that will kind of influence different Congress people to finally pass the Native American Religious Freedom Act to help preserve some of the burial grounds. So thank you, Courtney, for asking that question. Now, initially, the Sand Creek engagement is going to be reported as a victory against a brave opponent. And as we heard in the film clip, within weeks, witnesses and survivors raised the controversy about it being a massacre and not a victory. And several investigations were conducted, two by the military and one by the Joint Committee on the Conduct of War. And by going through this, perhaps, and Courtney, you had mentioned something about, not being appreciative of culture. Think about what we're doing right now in terms of a new enemy known as the Muslim religion, and how, we are ignorant of the Muslim experience. And, of course, it's very simple for us to just go ahead and support the military and what the military is doing in Afghanistan and Iraq, bombing away without us really appreciating the Muslim traditions, only because somebody attacked, we got to go after them. So I'm just going to read to you two testimonies from peoples who appeared before the Joint Committee on the Conduct of the War so that you can understand some of the atrocities that occurred as soldiers just went crazy. It's sort of like what happened in Abu Ghraib during the Iraq War. Now, I saw the bodies of those lying there cut to all pieces. This is John Smith. This is congressional testimony of Mr. Smith in 1865. Worse mutilated than I ever saw before. The women cut all to pieces, with knives, scalped, their brains knocked out, children 2 or 3 months old, all ages lying there, from sucking infants up to warriors. And by whom were they mutilated? By the United States troops. And another another person who provided congressional testimony was Stan Hoag. Fingers and ears were cut off the bodies for the jewelry they carried. The body of white antelope lying solitarily in the creek bed was a prime target. Besides scalping him, the soldiers cut off his nose, ears, and testicles, the last for a tobacco pouch. So kind of shares with you that there are those white citizens who were willing to take a stand, an unpopular stand, because you will always find that there are always those people who will stand up for justice. And despite the fact that their lives will be put on the line simply because they're taking an unpopular position. But throughout history, there has always been those who have stood up for the Native American. In fact, as you're going to be learning in this class, it takes all kinds of peoples to create justice, not just one group. So there's always been, there's good human beings and there's bad human beings. All right. I just so happen to like the red beans, all the beans that are real nice. I just don't like canned green beans. I don't know, but nonetheless, after the Civil War, the U.S. went on a protracted program of annihilation of Native peoples west of the Mississippi. It was an interesting time to be Native between 1860 to 1890. And today we appreciate the wars that Hollywood gives us. As we see wagon trains make their way west, and supposedly, in the west, it's this wilderness. That's where we get the term wild, whereas behind industrialized societies, everything is tame. Out there, the frontier, when you go into the frontier, there's all the animals, and you got to go hunt the animals, and you got to go and tame the wilderness. And then, of course, there's the Indians out there with that wild. So John Wayne made a career. Kevin Costner made a career. And then, of course, to add equal opportunity, Will Smith is going to come in and popularize this Wild West in the American imagination. Civility versus savagery. The wilderness needs to be tamed by these courageous people moving west. The U.S. military, the CIA, and the National Security Council still use these concepts of taming the wild in their descriptions of going after Muslims, of going after the new enemy. These policies that are designed to target enemies. Just take a look at what the military names its missiles. There's the Tomahawk missiles. There's the Apache helicopters. There's Comanche drones. And then, of course, in the capture of Osama bin Laden, Operation Geronimo. So you see, this mentality still is fixated. They still have this fantasy of this Wild West notion in the military. So recognize this citizenry. Now let's go to the Wounded Knee Massacre, because this is the last, this is the final fight. This is it. In the 1890s, the Native peoples, this is the last major battle. And the Wounded Knee Massacre happened on December 29th, 1890, near a place called Wounded Knee Creek on the Lakota Pine Ridge Indian Reservation in South Dakota. And on the day before, a detachment of the U.S. 7th Cavalry Regiment was commanded by Major Samuel M. Whitside, intercepted Spotted Elk, Bigfoot, band of Minneconjou, Lakota, and 38 Hunkpapa, Lakota, near Porcupine Butte, and escorted them 5 miles westward to Wounded Knee Creek, where they made camp. The rest of the 7th Cavalry Regiment, consisting entirely of recently arrived immigrants from southern and eastern Europe, arrived led by Colonel James Forsythe, will surround the encampment supported by 4 Hotchkiss guns, which is the precursor to the Gatling gun. And on the morning of December 29th, the troops went into the camp to disarm the Lakota. And one version of events claims that during the process of disarming the Lakota, a deaf tribesman named Black Coyote was reluctant to give up his rifle, claiming he had paid a lot of money for it. And a scuffle over Black Coyote's rifle escalated, and a shot was fired, which resulted in the 7th Cavalry opening fire indiscriminately from all sides, killing everybody in sight, women, men, children, as well as some of their own fellow troopers. And those few Lakota warriors who still had weapons began shooting back, and the attacking troopers quickly suppressed the Lakota fire. So the surviving Lakota fled, and U.S. cavalrymen pursued and killed many who were unarmed. And by the time it was over, At least 150 men, women, and children of the Lakota Sioux had been killed and 51 wounded. Four men, 47 women, and children will die later from the wounds. Some estimates place the number of dead at 300. And 25 troopers also died, and 39 were wounded. Six of those wounded would also die. And it is believed that many of those troopers were the victims of friendly fire, as the shooting took place at close range in chaotic conditions. So let's visit what recruited immigrants to the U.S. Army recently arriving from Southern and Eastern Europe to America so courageously performed on behalf of this nation's national interest. Let's visit the Wounded Knee Massacre.
A message of hope spread across the Great Plains. It was called the Ghost Dance, a dance to restore the past when Indian nations were free.
They danced without rest, on and on. Occasionally, someone thoroughly exhausted and dizzy fell unconscious into the center and lay there dead. The visions ended the same way, like a chorus describing a great encampment of all the Lakotas who had ever died, where there was no sorrow, but only joy, where relatives thronged out with happy laughter. The people went on and could not stop. And so I suppose the authorities did think they were crazy. But they weren't. They were only terribly unhappy.
Driven off their lands, Indian nations were confined to desolate reservations, dependent on corrupt government agencies for food and supplies.
The people were desperate from starvation. We felt that we were mocked in our misery. We held our dying children and felt their little bodies tremble as their souls went out and left only a dead weight in our hands. Red Cloud, Oglala.
The ghost dance hurt no one, but as it spread, white settlers panicked. The United States government outlawed the dance.
The white men were frightened and called for soldiers. We had begged for life, and the white men thought we wanted theirs.
On a mild day just after Christmas of 1890, a band of Hukwoju Sioux, under their leader Bigfoot, left the Cheyenne River Agency in South Dakota, heading for a meeting at Pine Ridge with Oglala leader Red Cloud. Traveling with Bigfoot were 106 men, and 252 women and children. Among them was a boy, Dewey Beard, who would later tell his children and grandchildren about that day.
Grandpa Dewey Beard being the last survivor, I would listen to what he had to say. In a way, it was sad, and yet it's beautiful because it's bringing back history. One thing that he would say is that had the soldiers, had the government left them alone, in time they would have looked outside and seen how things were changing, and the change would come about from within the bands.
Bigfoot's band was intercepted by the 7th Cavalry. The officer in charge found Bigfoot wrapped in heavy blankets, dying from pneumonia in the back of a wagon. Bigfoot was ordered to make camp along Wounded Knee Creek. In the morning, his people would be stripped of their weapons and escorted to Pine Ridge. Bigfoot made assurances of his peaceful intentions, and the band made camp.
He's a peaceful man. He's always say that, think about the elderly, think about the children and the woman. And don't start the trouble.
Morning broke after a sleepless night surrounded by soldiers. Huk Woju witnesses would later recall what happened next.
Bigfoot, who was sick, came up with a flag of truce tied to a stick. Dewey Beard.
As soldiers trained their guns on them, Bigfoot and his men brought forth all their weapons, placing them near the white flag of truce Bigfoot had planted in front of his lodge. The soldiers then searched their tents and wagons for arms, even confiscating cooking and sewing tools. As Bigfoot's people gathered around the flag of truce outside his tent, four powerful Hotchkiss rapid repeating guns were mounted above the camp.
I noticed that they were erecting cannons up here, also hauling up quite a lot of ammunition for it.
They encircled us like a band of sheep.
I could see that there was commotion amongst the soldiers, and I saw on looking back, they had their guns in position, ready to fire.
Thomas Tibbles, a white reporter who followed the troops to Wounded Knee, recorded what happened next.
Suddenly I heard a single shot from the direction of the troops. Then three or four, a few more, and immediately a volley. At once came a general rattle of rifle firing, then the Hotchkiss guns.
An awful noise was heard, and I was paralyzed for a time. Then my head cleared, and I saw nearly all the people on the ground, bleeding. My father, my mother, my grandmother, my older brother, and my younger brother were all killed.
And he saw his mother walking toward him. She was walking along, and she was shot. Dewey, she said, keep walking, my son. She said, keep going. She said, I'm going to die. And that was the last time he saw his mother.
The women, as they were fleeing with their babies, were killed together, shot right through. And after most of them had been killed, a cry was made that all those not killed or wounded should come forth and they would be safe. Little boys came out of their places of refuge, and as soon as they came in sight, a number of soldiers surrounded them and butchered them there. American Horse, Oglala.
The firing continued for an hour or two, wherever a soldier saw a sign of life.
Okay, so that's the Wounded Knee massacre. And so once Native nations have been, at least their resistance groups, been eliminated, the U.S. begins to implement a policy of benevolence. Because after all, genocide is not a nice word. Assimilation is preferred. So once the U.S. incarcerated them on reservations, a program eventually developed whereby the children would be taken from their parents and sent to boarding schools. And so this begins the boarding school era. And the best way, of course, as I shared with you in the last presentation, to get a culture to transform is to educate the children in the history of the conquering society. And once the children accept their version of history, then assimilation is complete. Once you accept the version of the dominant society's history of your people, you are conquered. And as we learned in the last presentation, an Indian boarding school refers to one of many schools that were established in the United States during the late 19th century to educate Native American youths according to Euro-American standards. And in some areas, these schools were primarily run by missionaries, especially given the young age of some of the children sent to the schools. They had been documented as traumatic experiences for the many of the children who did attend them. And they were generally forbidden to speak their native languages. They were taught Christianity instead of their native religions, and in numerous other ways were forced to abandon their Indian identity and adopt Euro-American culture. And tragically, many cases of mental and sexual abuse were documented. This forced boarding school era will come to an end under the New Deal in the 1930s. In 1924, Congress will grant Native peoples citizenship status. And under the 1924 Act, Indigenous peoples did not have to apply for citizenship, nor did they have to give up their tribal citizenship to become a U.S. citizen. After all, the 1920 census revealed that Native peoples represented not even half of 1% of the total U.S. population. So by the 1920s, the United States could grant them citizenship because they were no longer a threat to U.S. society. They became mascots in the American imagination. And so let's deal with this whole issue of mascots. Think about the stereotypes that you have had with regards to Native peoples. And of course, we have the Washington Redskins, the Cleveland Indians, and the Kansas City Chiefs. Because after all, peoples, Americans east of the Mississippi, don't run into quote unquote what an Indian should look like. When we take a look at, for instance, you know, what is it when we look at college football, the Seminoles, you know, hey, yeah, 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 hey, everybody's always doing that Indian chant, you know. And Indians are mascots because weren't they just great? They were part of the land and all of that. But you see, mascots, you know, they're not, they're not very threatening, are they? And of course, one of the most important things about feeling being an American is that you can at least connect to the land, so why not try to connect to the native past? So mascots become convenient tools, and after all, you know, as a hunter, you know, when you go out hunting, you know, you got your deer head, you got your buffalo head, you got your whatever animal head that you want, and then you got the Indian, up there. So, you know, the national sports, the professional sports, they still got these mascots. I have never seen a Cleveland Indian. I've never seen that Indian, you know, smiling like that. I've never seen an Indian like that, much less a Kansas City Chiefs and a Redskin. You know, when you take a look at a Redskin, the term Redskin came as a result of what happened in the 1620s when the Native peoples in Powhatan Confederacy, under the leadership of Opechancanough, attacked the Virginia settlement because they were abusing tobacco. And tobacco finally brought a profit. And they went and wiped out close to one-third of the Virginia population. Then Virginia in England went on a 20-year campaign to eliminate the Powhatan's Confederacy. Most of you know about Pocahontas. Powhatan was Pocahontas' dad. Opechancanough was Pocahontas' uncle. Well, they went after them for 20 years, and so this is where the term Redskin came, because they would scalp. They would scalp Native peoples. And the ways that you could do a scalp is just cut around the neck here, cut the skin around the neck and then just pull, and that would be a scalp, or you could cut around the headline here and then just pull. That was known as a top knot. And when they would turn in these top knots, it'd be dripping with red, and that's where you get the term Redskins. So it's most appropriate that the Washington Redskins are in Washington. I don't know if they'll ever agree to eliminate that mascot, but nonetheless, we have the mascots. So what I want to do is I want to address some of the stereotypes and share with you something, because I did bring my drum, and it was told to me that students, you wanted to know why about the drum. I was going to sing a song. I was going to sing what is known euphemistically in popular culture today as a war dance song. And maybe by singing a song, I can address some of the stereotypes that we have with regards to Native peoples. Now, you can imagine in the 19th century, growing up Native, the larger society does not want you. And if you belong to a group who is going to resist removal, you're going to have to prepare yourself to fight, because they're coming to remove you. And if you don't want to be removed, you're going to come into a fight. So if you were growing up, by the time that you were 10 years old, if you were a male and you were 10 years old, you have to learn to defend yourself. You had to become part of the military. And if you were a female, by the time you were 10 years old, you had to learn how to make munitions. So everybody was involved in the defense of the community. And so you had to prepare. When you prepared for war, it was very sacred because it took a while, because after all, when you go to war, you're going to take a life. You're going to take a life of a person, so you have to be responsible. When you go and you kill somebody, you're going to be responsible for that spirit that you take. And so it requires tremendous preparation. And then after the war, if you came back alive, that was fantastic. And so you can imagine coming back alive after a battle, the women, the children, and the elders all going around and trying to see who was coming back alive. And the women would lulu. They'd make this guttural sound of luluing, being proud and crying, that someone came back alive, whether it be an uncle or a nephew or a son or a grandson. Women would lulu. So dig that with regards to the stereotypes that we have. You know, the Indians are on the warpath. Here they go again. So look at the stereotype. It was a woman luluing in honor of someone coming back alive. And then they'd have a dance, which eventually became war dance songs, what I like to call them good to be alive songs, because then they'd honor those warriors who came back alive, and they'd have a war dance. And that's where the war dance comes from. It is in celebration of being alive. And so to end the appreciation for the red direction, the red beans, these real good red beans, I want to go ahead and end with a good to be alive song. It's a Kiowa war dance song. And I brought my drum with me so that I can sing a particular war dance song. It's a good to be alive song, and this is a Kiowa war dance song. So let's see if I can do my best with regards to appreciating something about being Native. What it's all about. So now, by understanding Native experiences with their environment and their eventual removal from their homelands, we can come to an appreciation of why every citizen of the United States must give thanks to the original inhabitants of this land, who at times welcomed immigrants and most often throughout history were forced through war to make room for immigrants. Ramzan, you have a question, Ramzan. Thank you very much. Was there any consequences to the soldiers for the massacre of Wounded Knee? Any reasons given as to why they were just not captured? Ramzan, that's a very good question. No, there was a court case, and I'll get back to you. I'll probably email you the specific court case, where they had to realize that they had to create what was known as a state of war, that there was a state of war, and then this way they rationalized the murder, the deaths of the peoples. And so it was in this way that the United States was able to rationalize all of that particular massacre. But I will provide for you that information through email. So if you can get on this camera, we've taken care of the red beans. Can we put the camera on these red beans here? Yes. Okay, we've taken care of the red beans now, so what we're going to do is let's go and take and appreciate the white beans. let's go to the white beans and let's appreciate their struggle to become part of the system. Let's revisit a film clip from the first presentation and appreciate the experiences of the early British settlers on this continent. Let's go back to the Mayflower.
This is the story of the Mayflower, actually, of the Pilgrim Voyage. Two or three days before they landed, the majority of the people there, over 50%, were indentured servants. And they staged a revolt on board. And what came out of it is the famous document known as the Mayflower Compact, where all the people there were declared themselves equal, free and equal. They revolted against the form of servitude that most of them had been committed, had signed up to put themselves under. And, you know, through a revolt of revolutionary servants, the first New England colony, Plymouth, became a democracy of sorts. It was a limited democracy, but it was the most democratic society at that time in colonial America. Well, in the colonies, most of the colonies, or all of the British colonies, were really set up by corporations. And as soon as possible, people who were hooked into it, who were often indentured servants, where they signed up for passage for a certain number of years, they would have to work off the money that the passage cost, and then they were able to get off on their own. And they, as soon as they got out, many of them just ran away and from that form of bondage, and went off into the wilderness. So, but as soon as they got into their own communities, into small towns, small villages, they were basically cooperative communities there. The cooperation was and democratic procedures were basically the way they settled the country in the early years.
Okay, so that kind of refreshes our memories with regards to what was covered in the second presentation of this course. Now, one of the reasons why people are in constant motion is that they are searching for opportunities to continue their economic existence. People are constantly searching for economic survival. Now, most often, people want to make sure that they can achieve a subsistence level that guarantees their families will be fed, clothed, and sheltered. In this way, we can appreciate that throughout human history, people have migrated throughout the world in search of a decent human existence. And likewise, it is most important to understand that wherever economic systems have been established, labor forces are required to create the infrastructure that facilitates the exchange of goods and services. So consequently, history reveals that systems are constantly looking to form and control labor forces so as to create markets as well as build the monumental architecture designed to enhance the exchange of goods and services. So it is the formation and control of labor forces that we want on the bottom thirds here, because throughout history we witness their formation, their control, in order to facilitate the enhancement of economic growth and development. But if we could put formation and control of labor forces first before indentured servants, I would appreciate it. Thank you very much. Whether it be organized through voluntary labor agreements, through enslaved labor, or contractual forms of labor, systems always desire people's skills. They want their knowledge, they want their experiences, they want their assets. In this way, systems recruit workers, as we were that one film clip shared with us. that these corporations wanted workers. Workers migrated to areas where their labor was valued, was required, and appreciated. So we want to appreciate that throughout the historical development of the United States, there was a constant need to form and control labor forces. We have a question from Courtney with regards to the Native American experience. Courtney, thank you for asking the question. Were the Dawes rolls part of the government program of genocide, or was there some other means, meaning behind them and those people's natives that signed on the roll? Courtney, you're referring to the Dawes Act. And the Dawes Act that was passed in 1882 was designed to, you know, one of the things that Native Americans, when they were moved to Oklahoma, were moved to lands that eventually Rockefeller is going to find oil underneath their lands. And so the Dawes Act was implemented to get Native peoples to become small property owners. And in this way, oil companies could come in to take over the lands that would be left over, you know, because on reservations, Native peoples, it was a socialist experiment because Native peoples owned the land in common. No one owned the land. It was owned by all. And the Dawes Act separated the land parcels into individual tracts, and eventually that Dawes Act, I guess maybe you could say was a part of genocide. It was a means by which to eventually get Native peoples off, out of reservations, and kind of they just kind of disappear. But thank you, Courtney, for asking that. Looks like, Courtney, that you have some background in Native American history. That's very, very good. Keep exploring and keep appreciating that dimension to the U.S. history. So throughout history, to get back with regards to the European experience, throughout history, we witnessed that formation and control of labor forces because economic growth needs enhancement. And whether it be organized through voluntary labor agreements, enslaved labor, or contractual forms of labor, systems want the skills, the knowledge, the experiences. So this need to form and control labor forces is tied to federal policy and international relations. Businesses in the United States rely upon the federal government to find them workers. And as we have understood in the previous presentation, since the colonial era, governments have been involved in securing voluntary as well as involuntary immigrants to this country. It is part of international policy. The U.S. federal government has been actively recruiting labor forces for this country since its inception. Treaties and negotiations are entered into to bring labor forces into the United States for its economic development and growth. So labor recruitment is the key to the migration of European populations, especially since the colonial period. The major distinction amongst European immigrants to the British colonies before the American Revolution related to the way in which they were able to afford passage to the colonies. This is where now we can put indentured servants here, because some peoples were able to immigrate on their own or their family resources, and we know that because if you have wealth, you're welcome in the United States. You don't have to, you can get your immigration process, you can go through the immigration process quickly. You know? Generally, if you have skills or capital, or you work in a specific profession as occupied positions in the expanding market, you're in. So government officials, clergy, merchants, artisans, farmers, gentry, lesser nobility, they could come in. But the mass of immigrants came as indentured servants or convicts. And the indentured were required to perform, as we heard in the clip, an average of 8 years of labor to repay the price of their passage. Because they lacked capital, because they lacked skills, they performed arduous labor. And many times, because of a lack of opportunity, their indentured status was extended. And their only opportunity for success was the British elimination policy of Native peoples from their land. Or, as happens so often, and all you have to do is just take a look at the eastern seaboard Native peoples that live today in Georgia, especially the Cherokee, the indentured servants could run away from their oppressive masters and join Native peoples' resistance movements. And many did. And that's why today when you take a look at the Cherokee that are coming from Georgia, they look blonde and blue-eyed, you know, just like Michael, one of our students, Michael Brannon. But they're Cherokee. They don't consider themselves white. They are Cherokee because, you know, cultures are living, cultures are constantly moving. This is a picture of Sitting Bull, but again, when we appreciate something about the Native experience, there's always been those whites who went to join Native peoples. In fact, the Shawnee have a great song about this one Irishman. They have an Irish Pat song that they always sing in honor of this particular man who helped the Shawnees as the Shawnees were being removed to Oklahoma. So there's always examples of European immigrants coming in, realizing transformation, they're changing, they see the system, and they go to the other side. We're going to have that example. The film clip emphasizes the importance of indentured servitude to the creation of the United States. And of course, John Curl discussed the Mayflower Compact. But most often, indentured rebellions, especially in the southern colonies, paved the way for their replacement as workers through the introduction of slavery. So white masters, when they don't like it when white workers rebel. And when white workers rebel, they're going to try to find other means by which to go beyond that rebellion. So whenever you see slavery appear in the British colonial empire, whether it be in the Caribbean area or in the southern seaboard slave states, it was usually preceded by white indentured servitude, and a servitude that many times led to white rebellion. So last time we learned of the first great wave of European immigrants coming across. And that first great wave was a steady flow of immigrants that had characterized the early 19th century, but then a torrent of people are going to come between 1840 to 1860. And historians identify this movement as the first great wave. So, excuse me, whereas annual immigration levels had numbered approximately 14,000 in the 1820s and 60,000 in the 1830s, the pace quickened to about 171,000 yearly in the 1840s and rose to about 260,000 yearly in the 1850s. So there's a lot of people coming across, and that's why the Native peoples are being removed to Oklahoma and making room for the surge in population. It came from the new national origins of the majority of immigrants. And before this era, most immigrants and Natives had been Protestants. And the majority in the first great wave, as we learned last time, they were Irish immigrants of the Roman Catholic faith and German immigrants of Jewish background. So cultural conflict and economic competition is going to ensue within the white direction. And as is frequently the case with immigrants, the Germans, the Irish, and others who arrived in the 1840s and in the 1850s concentrated in northeastern cities instead of spreading themselves evenly across the country. The Germans and the Irish concentrated in three major cities, New York, Philadelphia, and Boston. And the growth of the cities and the increasing volume of immigrants created a new dynamic in the history of immigration. Cities came to overlap with immigrant ethnic populations. And unregulated industrialization proceeded apace. The problems of the cities were often veiled in ethnic references to immigration and their descendants. Because of their language, because of their religion, because of their cultural practices, immigrants in the first great wave challenged the dominant culture of the United States. And for the most part, these immigrants were unskilled, and they were coming from rural communities. And the need of the U.S. economy required more labor and willingness to work. And the level to which they succeeded economically varied with the cycles of boom and bust in capitalism. Up until 1840, the states and the territories that the U.S. acquired sought populations. And the majority of the U.S.-born populations lived in rural areas. So immigrants who stayed in the city did not challenge the economic well-being of the majority of the U.S.-born. But in the 1850s, anti-immigrant mobilization appeared in the guise of a political party. It was known as the American Party or the Know-Nothing Party. And the American or Know-Nothing Party's agenda was a concern about immigrants, particularly about the cultural differences, particularly about the political differences, because the Know-Nothings perceived it came from the immigrants. And one of their demands was for an extension of the period prior to naturalization from 5 years to 21 years. And the party reached its peak in the 1856 election but it never strongly influenced national immigration policy. And its decline came at the onset of the Civil War, because the Civil War reshaped U.S. politics. It reshaped the party system. Concern over immigration policy in the 1850s was lost in a larger controversy over what to do with the involuntary immigrant, over what to do with the slave. Now, an important group of immigrants during this first great wave that helps us recognize injustice. Michael Brannon, you were asking something about, is there ever a time when white people had a conscience and tried to correct injustice? And yes, there's many, many instances of people's having a conscience, because like I shared with you, there are good human beings and there are bad human beings. And then, of course, there's green beans. But we must appreciate, let me just share with you an important group of immigrants during the first great wave that helps us to recognize the injustice that can be perpetrated by a powerful nation over a weaker one. And these are the San Patricios, the St. Patrick's Battalion. The St. Patrick's Battalion provides us a wonderful example of immigrants who witnessed injustice and took a stand against immorality. Now, you can imagine an immigrant population coming to the shores of this nation, wanting society to accept them on equal terms. And they decided to join the military. How many times have you heard of immigrants joining the military, trying to share with America they want to be a part of the system? They want to prove to America their desire to become part of an egalitarian experiment. Their journey leads them to experience a nightmare of prejudice, discrimination, segregation, and involvement in actions deemed as genocidal, the violent dismemberment of innocent elders, women, and children. So the racist expressions of the U.S. military in South Texas in 1846 is going to prompt an American soldier of Irish descent to defect the U.S. military and join the opposing forces. This man named John Riley convinces numerous immigrants, the majority being Irish and German, to take a stand against injustice. Now, before the United States declared war against Mexico, a battalion of Irish immigrants in the U.S. military decided to defect and join the Mexican side. They decided to fight for Mexico. When the United States declared war against Mexico, Captain John Riley and Los San Patricios, or the St. Patrick's Battalion, had already been formed, and they will meet their familiar enemy on the front lines of battles in the states of Tamaulipas, in Coahuila, and in Monterrey. The St. Patrick's Battalion will bravely fight for what they considered to be the side of justice, morality, and honor. And throughout the U.S. war with Mexico, the battalion will be reinforced by deserting immigrant soldiers of the American Army who, rather than run away from death, faced death by switching sides and chose to fight on the front lines against an enemy they judged morally in the wrong. The following film clip records the legends of the Los San Patricios, or the St. Patrick's Battalion. Let's listen to a song honoring the St. Patrick's Battalion, and let's witness a film clip from a movie honoring their heroic decision. Tom Berenger, in this film clip, plays Captain John Riley. And when the Irish are captured at the Battle of Churubusco, due to the fact that General Santa Anna retreats with his forces, leaving these immigrants vulnerable as prisoners of war, those who defected prior to the declaration of war will be spared death. Those who defected prior to the declaration of war will be branded with a letter D on their cheeks for deserter. Those who defected during the war will be condemned, or are condemned to be ceremoniously hung. And General Winfield Scott arrogantly proclaims that the hanging of the St. Patrick's Battalion is to occur once the American flag displaces the Mexican flag flown over the castle of Chapultepec. So let's watch today's modern rendition of the San Patricio's experience. In this film clip, we will see Tom Berenger taking on the role of John Riley, captain of the St. Patrick's Battalion. The scenes are taken from a film called One Man's Hero. And please listen to the words of the song composed especially for this movie. David Rovich performs stupendously in honor of these men who died for Mexico. Go to film clip.
My name is John Riley. I'll have your ear only a while. I left my dear home in Ireland. It was death, starvation, or exile. When I got to America, it was my duty to go. Enter the army and slog across Texas to join in the war against Mexico. And it was there in the pueblos and hillsides that I saw the mistake I had made. Part of a conquering army with the morals of a bayonet blade. And there amidst all these poor dying Catholics, screaming children, the burning stench of it all, myself and 200 Irishmen decided to rise to the call. From Dublin City to San Diego, we witnessed freedom denied. So we formed the St. Patrick Battalion, and we fought on the Mexican side. We formed the St. Patrick Battalion, and we fought on the Mexican side. We marched neath the green flag of St. Patrick, emblazoned with Erin Go Bragh. Right with the harp and the shamrock, and Libertad para Republica. Just 50 years after Wolfe Tone, 5,000 miles away, the Yanks called us a legion of strangers, and they can talk as they may. But from Dublin City to San Diego, we witnessed freedom denied. So we formed the St. Patrick Battalion, and we fought on the Mexican side. We formed the St. Patrick Battalion, and we fought on the Mexican side. We fought them in Matamoros while their volunteers were raping the nuns. In Monterrey and Cerro Gordo, we fought on as Ireland's sons. We were the red-headed fighters for freedom amidst these brown-skinned women and men. Side by side we fought against tyranny, and I dare say we'd do it again. From Dublin City to San Diego, we witnessed freedom denied. So we formed the St. Patrick Battalion, and we fought on the Mexican side. We formed the St. Patrick Battalion, and we fought on the Mexican side. Churubusco was the last. Overwhelmed by the cannons from Boston, we fell after each mortar blast. Most of us died on that hillside in the service of the Mexican fleet. So far from our occupied homeland, we were heroes and victims of fate. From Dublin City to San Diego, we witnessed freedom tonight. So we formed the St. Patrick Battalion, and we fought on the Mexican side. From Dublin City to San Diego, we witnessed freedom tonight. So we formed the St. Patrick Battalion, and we fought on the Mexican side. We formed the St. Patrick Battalion, and we fought on the Mexican side.
Okay, so that's the most powerful episode in the immigrant history, especially during the first wave. And when John Riley was in prison, he penned a letter to a friend in Michigan explaining to him why he made the decision to fight against the United States. In it, he hinted that the war was immoral and that the war reflected the experience of the Irish to the British in their defense of the homeland. He wrote, "In all my letter, I forgot to tell you under what banner we fought so bravely. It was the glorious emblem of native rights, that being the banner which should have floated over our native soil many years ago. It was the St. Patrick, the harp of Erin, the shamrock upon the green field." We have a phone call from someone out in Cable Land. Thank you very much for calling in. Kathy, calling in from Sylmar. Thank you, Kathy.
Hi. I was calling in about a question a friend had for me. Mm-hmm. You guys, in 2011 today, knowing what we know about the white people being racist, why is the statue of the president still mount on Rushmore? Isn't that a slap to the Navajo Indian?
No, go ahead. I'm sorry.
Isn't that the same as like a Nazi sign being put up?
You know, when you say a white racist, one of the things that I've been, I'm not sure I get an echo, when we talk about a policy, now there are those who are in positions of power to implement policy. So it's not that, you know, when we talk about all white people are racist, no, you have to be in a position of power to be a racist. And this way that you can implement laws and legislation that puts you in an advantageous position and put others in a disadvantaged position. Now, with the issue with regards to Mount Rushmore is in the Midwest. It has nothing to do with the Navajos. It has to do with all of the Sioux. And Mount Rushmore was, yes, it is a monument to honor in the United States of four great leaders that kind of were part of American diplomacy. So you have four presidents that are up there, and I understand that they want to add Ronald Reagan to it. I don't know. But yes, when we take a look at that monument, it is a disgrace to Native peoples, simply because that mountain was sacred for Native peoples, and they destroyed a religious site just to put up a particular monument that would honor something that's great about America. As far as it being considered with regards to being Nazi, in terms of Nazism, I think that's stretching it a bit, but we can't put it within the context of removal and appreciate that the United States has its own unique history with fascism. I wouldn't compare it to what Hitler did. The United States is certainly unique in its own experiences. Thank you, Kathy, for asking that question from Sylmar. I don't know if I clarified anything for you outside of the fact that when we do discuss particular issues with regards to history, put them in a particular context, in their historical context. And yes, we can find comparisons. Everybody does find comparisons. Now, one of the things, I put these three beings here. Now, let me see if I can we can get the. I got three beans now. We've dealt with the red beans. We've got the white beans. And one of the things about the Civil War is that it had to deal with the black beans. You know, the black beans. We've got the white beans. We've got the red beans. And the black beans are very important for us to appreciate. Let me see if I can move. Oops. I'll get this done here. When we talk about the Civil War devastated the South. And it left the country in shambles. And as we will learn next week, when we deal with slavery or the involuntary immigrant experience, Reconstruction, or the nation's first civil rights movement, is going to bring the nation three important amendments to the Constitution. And those are the 13th, the 14th, and the 15th Amendments to the Constitution that we'll learn more about. Yet America was not ready to put black beans on an equal footing with the white beans. And so there was what became known as the Compromise of 1877. And that compromise is where we're going to take off next week and appreciate something about the compromise that'll take us into the second great wave. But meanwhile, Michael, we have a statement from Michael. It says the separation of nationalities in the U.S. military continues. Foreign nationals may join and serve, but hold positions that do not require a security clearance, such as storekeepers and clerks. Well, thank you for that point of clarification, Michael. Appreciate it. The fact that foreign nationals can serve, but not hold positions. Appreciate it. And so we need to appreciate something about the experiences with regards to what I'm going to be covering next week, the first civil rights movement. And we're going to talk about the second wave of immigrants that are going to come in, because the second wave of immigrants are going to come in during a time of a tremendous conflict. And it's going to be the year 1877. We're going to start covering next time that we meet a year that one historian, Alan Nevins, wrote was one of the blackest in the nation's annals. And the economy was in its deathbed. The democracy was non-existent. Unemployment and bankruptcy, business failures, severe depression, all of this encouraged violence, created poverty, and it wrought despair. And the presidential election of 1876 was tainted by fraudulent vote counts and was thoroughly corrupt. So clearly, democracy was not the dream of perfection that was anticipated by immigrants coming to the shore of this nation. And then there was what General George Custer will lose a tremendous battle that will challenge the nation's military establishment. So the violence and the hypocrisy of the era is going to encourage a famous writer named Mark Twain to label the era the Gilded Age. So next week we will continue with the European immigrant tradition, and students, I will adjust the requirements, the due dates for the next discussion board as we try to deal and gather and try to appreciate first the white beans. We're going to do the white beans, and then we'll get to the black beans. But I do like green beans. It's just canned. They just don't do it for me. But thank you.